All right. Good afternoon and welcome to the first class of EE5332. The course is titled Mapping DSP Algorithms to Architectures. What I'll be doing is in the first day today is explaining a little bit more about what exactly that title means, what you can expect to be covered in this course, and a little bit about the expectations from you as well as how the course is going to be conducted. So I'll start with an overview. This overview is primarily going to be, or rather this overview is basically going to talk about what is going to be covered in today's lecture. I'll start by looking at the concepts that are going to be covered in this course, some of the prerequisites and some reference material, although the detailed reference material we'll be giving to you as and when we get to specific instances of assignments or specific topics that we are covering. The structure of the course, what I mean by administration is mostly, what are the sort of logistics involved in the course, what are the lecture hours, how will the labs be conducted, when are the exams and so on, grading method. And then I'm basically going to start off with assignment one, which is in some way a sort of a way for you to gauge whether you are at the right level for this course. If you find it difficult to do assignment one, then you basically need to sort of use that in order to decide what are the parts where you need to catch up and how are you going to go about doing it. And finally, I'm also going to have a small quiz. The quiz will essentially, it's just a 10-minute multiple choice type of quiz that we have over here. Once again, same goal. The questions that are being asked on that quiz are things that you are already expected to know as background for this course. And if you have trouble with the questions on that quiz, then again, you need to go back and figure out how to catch up on those on that material. All right, so let's start with the concepts that are involved in the course. The title is, there are multiple versions of the title. The working title that I'm going to use is Mapping DSP Algorithms to Architectures. So what I'm going to do is start by taking the definition essentially of each of those words and seeing if we can understand a little bit better what is going to be covered in the course. Okay, so first we'll start with signal processing. What do we mean by a signal? The dictionary definition, or it turns out that if you go to an online dictionary and look for the word signal, you find multiple definitions. So I'm sort of picking and choosing over here. I've just picked out the definition that most closely matches with what is relevant as far as this course is concerned. So in this case, what I mean by a signal is any detectable physical quantity or impulse, such as a voltage, current, or magnetic field strength, by which messages or information can be transmitted. Okay, and in practice, that's pretty much what we are talking about. One example of signals would be the audio, the microphone that's capturing my voice and recording it, right? Or the camera that's basically picking up the video scene in front and recording it. All of those are examples of signals, right? In this case, ultimately what is happening is there is a physical quantity, such as either the pressure waves from what I'm speaking or the light being converted using photo detectors, which is converted into either a voltage or a current and then being quantized by means of an analog to digital converter, right? But the main point is there is a message or information that needs to be transmitted, and that is what we mean by signal. Processing, to subject to examination or analysis. This is as broad as it gets, right? What can you do with a signal? What do we mean by processing a signal? It's pretty much anything that, it might be just looking at the maximum amplitude of the signal, or, is one particular frequency component present in the signal? Or maybe modifying the signal in some way by filtering out some parts, some frequencies, right? Maybe in an image you sort of want to amplify edges, or detect edges and sort of make them sharper, things of that sort. All of those are broadly just considered as processing as far as we are concerned. And an algorithm, a step-by-step procedure for solving a problem, okay? So it's literally that. So when I say something like an example of, filtering, right? So I said, okay, maybe I can apply a filter to eliminate some frequencies from my voice. That would mean that I first need to capture the signal, convert it into a format that can be processed, and the processing that I do is basically going to involve some kind of numerical computation, which finally results in an output, once again a signal, that has different properties from what I started. And the algorithm involved is the steps that are required in order to actually accomplish this. Okay. So let's look at some properties of signal processing algorithms. I'll be going into this in more detail in the next class, but this is just sort of a quick overview. What sets signal processing algorithms apart from the general idea of algorithms that you might do in, that you might look at in, for example, a data structures and algorithms course, right? One of the properties is that they are numerically intensive. What that means is there's a lot of what we sometimes call number crunching, right? You basically have a set of numbers and you are doing certain kinds of operations with them, which means that you also need to worry about how you represent those numbers, right? And that will also be one of the things that we cover in a little bit more detail in one of the succeeding lectures, right? To use, what does it mean to take a real valued number and then represent it in a format that a computer can manipulate, okay? Which is related to the problem of the bit width of the representation. How many bits do you need in order to represent a signal, the value of a signal? Another property of signal processing algorithms, which turns out to be very important and useful as we go forward, is that the concept of controlled flow, right, or branching is very limited in typical signal processing algorithms, right? Like I said, we'll get into more examples of that moving forward, but at a broad level, all that it's saying is when you write a program typically in C or C++, one of the things that you would do is you might have a lot of if statements or switch case statements, things like that. And the whole idea is that signal processing algorithms have very limited kinds of such conditionals, right? They are applying the same set of operations repeatedly on a large number of data, okay? Which also leads to them being sometimes referred to as data flow type of operations. Essentially, what that means is the data is present, it's obtained in some way, and it just pretty much flows through the system, undergoing some transformations along the way. A related concept is that of so-called streaming applications. And by streaming, you are probably used to the word streaming in the context of video, right? Or sometimes even of audio, where essentially what we mean is rather than downloading an entire movie and watching it at one shot, you are streaming in only the relevant part, the portion that you are actually currently watching. And only that part needs to be processed, right? That roughly does match with the idea of streaming that we have over here, which is basically that, you know, you are continuously dealing with samples and the computation that you need to do is only related to the immediate neighborhood of the present sample that you have. So you don't need to store the entire history of the data in order to process the next sample. There is some way by which you can collapse that state into a simpler form such that you can process samples one at a time. So the samples themselves could come from multiple sources. Typical sources are 8 analog to digital converters. File storage, maybe you are reading a .avi file in order to play a movie or display something on screen. It could be a camera which is basically taking snapshots of or photographs, converting them into some image format. Right? All of those can be thought of as samples. And in fact, one of the things that we'll see as we move forward is the notion of a sample itself needs to be understood better, right? So for example, when we are talking about an image, what is the right granularity at which I should talk about or for video, for example, should I be talking about the samples as being the individual pixels in the image, or should I take one entire frame of the video as one sample? Okay, so those are, again, that comes down to the question of at what level are we going to analyze the algorithm and how are we going to process it? An important property, once again, which we'll get into in more detail in the next class, is that the rate over here is in many cases determined by physical factors, okay, that have nothing to do with the computational speed of the hardware that you have. So an example of that is we know that human voice, typically most of the relevant content falls within the first 4 kilohertz or so of audio frequencies. And even if you stretch it, you know, you're probably not going to go above 8 kilohertz or so, which means that as long as you're able to sample at somewhere around 20 or so kilohertz or maybe 40 just to play safe, you definitely are not going to miss out on any of the content in the data, which means in turn that there is really no point in processing it any faster than that, because your data from the A to D converter will not come at a rate faster than that. Okay, how do we make use of that is again something that we will look into as we move forward. Examples, broadly you can sort of look at signal processing applications and classify them in a few different ways. One of them is algorithms for analysis of signals. These include filtering, the finite impulse response and infinite impulse response filters being the usual suspects over here. Transforms, discrete Fourier transform, discrete cosine transform, variants of that, right? Many different transforms exist, each of which basically allows you to modify a signal in a certain way or extract certain information about it. All these are used for analysis, to understand more about the signal, the content of the signal. Then there are some algorithms that relate to compression. Compression, once again, broadly two types of signals are the most well studied. One of them is speech and the other is video. Speech coding, therefore, is one of the most well studied forms of compression. How do I take audio speech and compress the amount of information in it, or compress the number of bits required to store it, such that there is little or no loss in quality? Okay. Vector quantization came up in the same context. It basically was related to the concept of how do you compress speech. Basically, you convert it into a set of features and then you are able to do a quantization or some kind of compression across different sets of features. But it also has applications in various other places where you are trying to sort of match signals or extract features and match them against others. Comparison mostly falls in the pattern recognition domain, right? So speech recognition, image recognition are broad classes of comparisons, right? And there are many different ways. So for example, how does Google Voice, for example, recognize what I'm speaking and convert it into text, right? Or how do, when you upload a photo to Facebook or Google, how does that detect a face and in fact find out who it is and classify it appropriately, okay? Now, all of these things fall broadly in the domain of signal processing, right? And many of them, in fact, fall under the category of so-called linear time invariant processing systems, right? But as far as this course is concerned, we are not going to restrict ourselves to that. We will also look at some applications that may not fall in the traditional domain of signal processing, although it's debatable. I mean, it depends on who you ask. They may or may not call it signal processing. Usually when you talk about DSP systems, the expectation is that you are talking about linear time invariant systems, but that's not going to be a restriction in our case. So for example, we will also consider applications from cryptography in the domain of signal processing, right? Now, strictly speaking, there is very little connection with signal processing over here, because the kind of operations that you are going to do in cryptography are not even numerical, they are mostly bit manipulation, right? But they offer many other properties that are very similar to signal processing applications, such as the streaming pattern, the rate determined by external factors, and so on, so that you can still apply the same concepts that we have over here that we get from the study of signal processing systems to cryptographic systems as well. Okay. Error correcting codes, well, these have both. They have some amount of bit manipulation, but also a large amount of numerical computation involved over here, right? So they sort of fall in both categories. There is some amount of regular numerical computation, but also some amount of bit manipulation, which may not typically be considered as signal processing otherwise. And of course, neural networks, right? Now, why am I sort of considering neural networks as something slightly different? Simply because they are nonlinear, but apart from that, they very well fall in the category of signal processing systems, okay? So the fact that, for example, transforms or frequency analysis cannot directly usually be applied in the context of neural networks doesn't take away from the fact that they involve the same kind of operations. You are doing extensive number crunching, right? There's a huge amount of data, and they pretty much have the same kind of structure as other signal processing algorithms. data flowing in, being processed by some numerical computation, and finally flowing out at the other end. Okay? So, in other words, all of these will also very much fall within our definition of signal processing applications. Now, getting to the term architecture, right? Formation or construction resulting from or as if from a conscious act. I couldn't find a better definition that was even close to what we want. But the other one, the more sort of normal definition, is the manner in which the components or of a computer or computer system are organized and integrated, right? Now, what we are looking at is somewhere in between these two. Why I'm saying that is because we are not just interested in a computer system. We are actually going to be looking at a situation where we might want to construct the architecture, a specific custom architecture that does not previously exist, and use it for our purposes. Okay? So, again, you know, there will be pretty much an entire lecture going into the details of architectures, but broadly, you can sort of look at the spectrum of architectures as this. The first is so-called fully custom hardware, right? The kind of stuff where every element in the design is pretty much handcrafted. The adders, the multipliers, the registers, each one is sort of designed at the transistor level, put together. Very difficult to design, but by far the best that you can get in terms of the performance, right? Where once again, what do we mean by the best performance? Is it speed? Is it area? Is it power? Is it cost? All of those we will again be looking at later. There is also a concept of semi-custom hardware where you will use a lot of predefined modules. So somebody else might have designed a multiplier. Somebody else might have designed, in fact, an ALU unit, right? Or a register file. And you start putting those together and creating your own hardware architecture, right? A lot simpler to design, but you lose some flexibility because, you know, the source that you use might only have designed a 16 cross 16 multiplier, whereas you actually want to, you know, optimize your number of bits and use only 13 bit numbers. You can't really do that if you want to use a predefined module. Programmable hardware is pretty much where the bulk of this course is going to sit, because we will be using FPGAs as our target architecture. We will be taking designs, mapping them onto FPGA architectures, and, you know, essentially getting them mapped onto those and evaluating them and testing them out on those architectures. Okay, what is an FPGA? A field programmable gate array basically means that you have an array of gates whose functionality and interconnections can be programmed in the field, can be modified at runtime, so to say. Okay, so a lot more of that will come up later in the course. We will be having lab sessions, so we'll get to that as well in more detail. There is also the concept of so-called domain-specific programmable processors. These are usually the traditional DSPs, digital signal processors. And nowadays, increasingly, the GPUs, graphic processing units. Okay, for a while, the term GPGPU was used, general purpose graphic processing unit. Nowadays, people just say GPU, and, you know, it's understood that you are talking about a high performance graphic processing unit with certain computation capabilities. Now, these are in some sense domain specific. What that means is they are making certain assumptions, such as the fact that you are interested in doing a lot of multiplications and additions, and you need to have a specific kind of memory access pattern, and therefore they optimize the architecture, right? They use those assumptions in order to optimize the architecture. Now, if I wanted to, for example, write an operating system, a GPU is probably going to be a terrible platform on which to run something like an operating system, because, you know, the amount of control flow and branching that I have while writing the resource control inside an OS is completely unsuited to what happens on a GPU. It can be done, but it's very wasteful. So that's why I'm calling them domain specific. And the last one is essentially the so-called general purpose programmable CPUs, right? Something like your Intel Xeon or the i7 processor, which is capable of executing any kind of operation, right? It's perfectly well suited to running an operating system. At the same time, it can also it usually has some kind of extensions or some custom hardware that allows it to run certain numerical computations also well. Okay, and in fact, in our case, what we will end up doing is we'll be working somewhere between programmable hardware and general purpose processors. Because in fact, what we will do is we will look at a CPU, take applications, run them on general purpose CPUs, find out where the bottlenecks are, and then see how they can be improved. Lastly, we come to the term mapping. There's really no relevant dictionary definition that I could find. So let's go through the steps of what we are going to study when we use the term mapping, right? The first step would be understand the constraints of the algorithm and the architecture. So what kind of algorithm are you trying to implement? FIR filter or an FFT or some kind of a neural network? And what kind of architecture? Is it a general purpose processor? Is it a DSP or a GPU? Is it an FPGA with certain blocks already defined on it? Specify which elements of algorithm will be implemented by which elements of architecture. What that means is, in the context of something like a GPU, let's say I have many multiplications to be done, which GPU core is going to implement which multiplication? Usually you don't go down and specify to that level, but that's part of what needs to be done in order to get the implementation completed. Measure the effectiveness and usefulness of the mapping. This is going to be an important part of what we do, which is basically saying, okay, now I have an architecture that can implement my algorithm. Is it a good architecture? In other words, anytime I want to implement a neural network, the simplest thing to do is take the latest and greatest GPU from NVIDIA, write my code on it, and it will always run. That's the best that I can really get in terms of performance. But in order to run that, I basically need one huge server, a huge amount of power, and large amounts of memory in order to even get such a system operational. Which definitely means that I'm not going to be able to sort of fit it into a, you know, handheld device or a mobile phone. So was it really useful, or was it, you know, just a waste of resources to take such a powerful processor and put it over there? So how do we measure the effectiveness and usefulness of this mapping? That's an important part of what we need to understand. Once we have that, we can modify either the algorithm or the architecture if we have control over that. And the aim is to try and improve some of those metrics. What could the metrics be? Cost, speed, power, area, any one of those, right? How do we improve it? Maybe we can get a smaller piece of hardware that does the same thing, less expensive. All of those are options. Or we can modify our algorithm, right? Instead of a certain kind of FFT, maybe I can use fewer bits, or I can run it in parallel and maybe make better use of the hardware that I have available. All of those options. Go back to step one, right? Once again, once you have made the modifications to your algorithm or architecture, you go back to step one, understand the new constraints that you have, and repeat. So in other words, this is primarily an iterative process. In general, there is no perfect unique answer, okay? All right, the approach that we will use in the course is going to be using hardware accelerators. What I mean by that is, like I said, we will use a general purpose CPU first, obtain a functional description of the code that will run on that CPU, and, you know, use custom modules for specific functions. The code will initially target pure software on a general purpose processor and will profile and identify the bottlenecks. So profiling and identifying bottlenecks will be part of what we learn how to do in the course. And if you are using custom hardware, or if you say that, you know, I could do this faster or better by using a custom piece of hardware, then you need to justify what exactly would be improved by using that. And then say, okay, fine, you know, let's use the custom hardware. Because the first thing to keep in mind is, in general, pure software on a general purpose processor is the simplest to write and debug. So if you can do it, if that meets all your requirements, just use it. Don't try to design hardware. Okay, so you should have a good justification for using hardware, which basically, you know, justifies the extra effort that is involved, not just in time, but also in debugging, maintenance, and in general, you know, getting the thing working. Okay. Now, what this means is that one of the things that we will have to understand better and study in more detail will be, what are buses? How do we interface custom hardware accelerators with CPUs? How do those custom hardware accelerators talk to the main memory system of the CPU? All those kind of interfaces and interface design will be very important factors that we need to consider. Learning objectives, this is not a very sort of rigorous or official set of learning objectives, but it's just something that I put down so that you can use this as a benchmark for what to expect. One of the things would be to describe, you should be able to describe the characteristics of computationally intensive algorithms, some of which I already mentioned earlier. More details we'll be looking at later. Identify bottlenecks or the critical computations, or it may not be computations, it might just be communication. How do I read write from memory, right? But how do I identify where the bottleneck is? What is preventing my algorithm from running at the performance that I need? Map an algorithm onto a given architecture and measure metrics of quality. Once again, what are those metrics? How do we measure them? Identify modifications of the algorithm that can improve the quality of the design, and identify modifications of the architecture that can improve the quality of the design. Okay. And finally, on the practical side, we will be using high-level synthesis tools to implement hardware accelerators for given problems on a system on FPGA platform. Okay. So let me just break quickly over here and do a quick round of the room. How many of you are first year MTech? Okay, I think the majority is first year MTech. Second year MTech? Okay. BTech? Okay. So that includes dual degree, or is it, okay, what about dual degree separately? Okay. And MS, PhD, project? Okay, fine. So how many of you have used FPGAs before? Okay, good, a reasonable number, although I would hope to see more. The reason I'm saying that is because one thing to keep in mind over here is this course, we do have a good set of TAs who have practical experience putting things on boards, but it is not going to teach you the basics of how to use an FPGA platform. Okay, having said that, the course is being structured in such a way that there will be a significant amount of time spent for lab resources, which means that you basically use that time in order to learn how to use an FPGA platform and whatever background is required over there. Okay, which basically brings me to the prerequisites. Let's sort of go into that in a little bit more detail. What are you expected to already know? What do you need to learn on your own? And how do you go about it? Okay, and by the way, one other thing, the class is being recorded for use later on as part of the NPTEL courseware, but still that means that you can ask questions. The way that I'll be handling questions and so on in class may be slightly different than how it would be in a regular classroom, but that does not sort of say that you should hold off questions till the end. If you have a question or a doubt, then feel free to ask at any point. So any questions, right? Okay, so prerequisites. What are you already expected to know? DSP. Okay, so digital signal processing. This course will not teach you anything about DSP. It will not teach you what a signal is, how a signal is sampled, why you should sample at a certain rate, what kind of transforms do you do. None of that will be covered over here. Filters and the basic transforms, Fourier transform, cosine transform, etc., you should know what they are. Things like compression, pattern recognition, and so on are useful, but may not be essential to the course because we can make do with whatever is there in the basics, filters and transforms and so on. From the point of view of hardware design, once again, you are expected to already know the basics of hardware design. What I mean by that is, in particular, one thing that you need to know is what is a critical path in a circuit. Okay. So what is it that determines the maximum speed at which a given VLSI circuit can operate? Okay, you don't need to know how it is implemented at the transistor level or how gates are built up out of transistors, but given a circuit, how would somebody go about understanding what is the maximum speed at which it can operate? So for example, when I say that I have an Intel i7 core processor running at 3 GHz, what does that actually mean? What is limiting it to 3 GHz per clock cycle, or rather, that 0.3 nanoseconds per clock cycle, right? Why could it not run faster than that? What is it physically that prevents it from going above that? You need to have a broad understanding of what is limiting it there. Power dissipation is something that we will be discussing as part of some of the modifications to the algorithms and architectures that we look at. Not very crucial as far as the course is concerned, but still useful to know, because you know there will be places where we will say that okay, this particular design consumes less power than another one. And in order to understand that, you need to know what is the source of power dissipation. Typically in CMOS circuits, it comes about because capacitances are being switched. Okay, so the majority of you, E18M at least, should have, I think, done the digital IC design course. How many have not done digital IC design? Okay, so there are a significant number who have not done digital IC design. Most of this would have been covered over there, but you don't need to do the entire course in order to follow along with what we are going to cover here, right? Any basic book on digital design that is not purely at the gate level, even at the gate level, there would be discussions of propagation delay, setup time, hold time, critical paths, and so on. So even a basic book on digital design should basically cover what you need to understand from the point of view of this course. Programming, okay? C, C++, it's assumed you already know C and C++, okay? You don't need to use any advanced object-oriented practices or anything of that sort. When I say C++, pretty much my definition of C++ is C in, C out for input, output, and new, delete for memory management, right? But there will be one particular set of C++ constructs that you will use, which is part of the standard library. There is something called the complex numbers, right? So there is the std colon colon complex, which is used in order to create complex numbers out of floating point or integer values. It just makes life easier, right? Rather than writing your own functions for manipulating complex numbers. And it turns out that the high level synthesis tools are able to recognize and implement those. So we will make use of things of that sort. That's fairly trivial to pick up as long as you are already comfortable with the basics of C. Within C, memory management, you need to have familiarity with, but the details of what goes on the heap, what goes on the stack, how is memory managed inside a processor, not too much. We don't worry too much about that, right? You do need to understand what is an array, how is an array laid out in memory, and so on, because we will be using arrays in order to implement code, and at the end of the day, that becomes a significant part of what we do. Linux command line, what I mean by that is you will have to be able to compile and run programs as well as some amount of debugging, because there will be a fair amount of programming that is going to happen as part of this course. Core requisites, what I mean by that is things which you may not already know, but you will have to pick up as part of this course. Verilog, right? We are not going to do a lot of programming in Verilog, but there will be one assignment coming pretty soon, okay? Which we will not be teaching you Verilog. We will give you pointers to online resources that will help you with learning Verilog. But the reason why you need to understand a little bit of Verilog is because even though we are using high-level synthesis, which means we will write C code and synthesize it, in order to understand what that hardware corresponds to, you need to have a basic working knowledge of what Verilog is. Okay? And I am primarily interested in Verilog as a hardware description language used for synthesis. Verilog originally was designed purely for the purpose of simulation. So there are a lot of constructs in Verilog that relate only to simulation, none of which are of particular interest to us, right? I only care about the parts that you need to understand in order to figure out how a particular thing is getting implemented. Numeric Python or MATLAB, again, not essential, but they could be useful to help you prototype certain functions. That's all. So once again, I'm not going to make that a prerequisite, but you will probably find it easier to do some assignments if you know that. LaTeX or some other form of documentation. You could even use OpenOffice or Google Docs or whatever it is, provided that your documentation looks good at the end, right? So please keep that in mind. As far as I'm concerned, just because you used Word or LaTeX does not mean your documentation looks good. What I'm interested in is documentation that is actually good and readable, okay? How you do it is less of a concern. So the formatting does not matter, the content is more important, which is why I am saying LaTeX. LaTeX focuses more on the content than the formatting. Good figures, plots, things like that actually demonstrate what it is that you are trying to say. Okay? all those are expected. References will be provided to the extent possible, but you are also expected to share among each other and self-learn as far as possible. Now, course structure, I'll sort of run through this a bit quickly because it's, you know, it's logistics, you need to know this, but it's not really useful information. The total course goes up approximately around 14 weeks, but you know, there are a couple of weeks that are only half. So overall, I'm counting it as roughly around 50 odd lecture hours. But what I expect to take is roughly in the range of around 30 to 35 lecture hours is probably where I'll be stopping. The rest of it is going to be for labs and pretty much self-study, right? Why self-study? Because there is a significant project that will come in. So you can, it's up to you whether you, you know, sit in the lab and work on it or you use that time separately. But if you sort of say that, you know, I'll work on it later, then you are likely to be in trouble. This is a fairly significant project that is expected from all of you. And once again, the TAs are under no obligation to respond if they are not contacted during the lab hours. So please respect their time as well, right? You can, of course, communicate with them using email and other methods, but they can be present during the lab hours. Anytime outside of that, you will have to sync up with them and find out if that's possible or not. Assignments. There will be a lot of assignments in the course. They will all involve programming of some sort or the other. Most of them will be in C. At least one will be in Verilog, some possibly in Python, but mostly C. So the method that we will use for assignments is that you will be given a boilerplate code, something that we call a test bench, okay? And you will be given a problem definition. And what you are expected to do is write the actual functionality that you need such that it fits within that template test bench code. And when compiled and run, it will, you know, the test bench should be able to say pass or fail, right? First of all, it should compile. And once it compiles, when you run that test bench, the test bench should be able to say, yeah, you know, you did the right thing or you did not do the right thing, right? And please make sure you understand how to do that at an early stage because we will be using this method throughout the course. The reason why we are doing it is because there are a large number of students in the class. This has to be semi-automated or fully automated if possible. So you submit the function in a specific format. It will go into a test bench and be compiled and run on our servers. Okay. So you can't then come and say, you know, but if I compile it this way or if I run the command this way, then it runs. No, you have to be able to submit the code and get it compiled with our servers at the other end. There will be one midterm exam. So as of now, the target date that I'm setting is March 2nd. It's a Saturday, okay, roughly a week after the first quiz. So please reserve that date. That's about 6 weeks into the course. I expect that a large part of the theory should be covered by then. So it would be a good time to basically have the exam. Okay, it will just be one midterm exam. But there will also be what I'm calling micro quizzes, which are of a 10 to 15 minute duration. Usually they will be at the end of the Wednesday class. So today we'll kick things off with a micro quiz immediately after the class. Okay. There will be a significant project that is expected of you. And as far as the project, the assignments you are expected to work on individually. But the projects are expected to be in groups of at least two, possibly three, but not more than three, because more than three, invariably at least one person is not doing anything. Okay. So, but at least two, because I can't have like 70 different projects either. Okay. So the more details of this and what is expected will be given closer to the midterm. Pretty much immediately after that is when you can start on the project. The intent is that you choose some kind of a hardware accelerator, a function, a problem, and implement it as a hardware accelerator for some compute intensive problem. Okay. There will be one, or we are looking at whether possibly more than one, sample project that will be given as the default. If you can't think up of a problem of your own, then you can use that. Having said that, you may not see great improvements by using that particular project. Still see what help we can. At least you should be able to do the analysis and so on in a reasonable way. But you are strongly encouraged to come up with problems of your own. What that means is if there is something else that you are working on that you know requires better computation, then please feel free to implement that in some way and you know demonstrate that you can actually get speed up on the hardware by whatever modifications or architecture that you build and implement. But the problem definition has to be vetted by me before you, go ahead and actually implement it. So the sooner that you can come up with a possible problem statement, the better. Grading, about 10%, well, 10% is basically going to go to the micro quizzes. I expect around 8 to 10 micro quizzes to be conducted over the course of the semester. The best N-2 of those will be taken. So what that means is you can do badly in two of them and it's not going to affect your grade, or you can miss two of them and that doesn't affect your grade either. No makeups will be given for those quizzes. 30% goes to the midterm exam. It will be a typical exam with a time limit, etc., etc., written test completely. Okay. 30% will go to assignments, which you are expected to submit online. There will be deadlines associated with the assignments. As and when you miss deadlines, you are still allowed to submit, but there will be graded penalties. So pretty much the idea is the moment you have missed a deadline, the maximum mark that you can get for that assignment already drops to 90%. After a few more days, it will drop to 70%, then 50%, and then pretty much die down to zero after a while. Okay? So you can submit late. You can pretty much submit your assignments all the way till the end of the semester, but you're not going to get many marks for it. So try and meet the deadlines to the extent possible. Do not ask for deadline extensions for the same reason. Project, once again, 30%, right? But this will involve a couple of things. One is a presentation to be made by the group, documentation, and individual vivas, because I also need to make sure that when you're working in a group of two or three, everyone is at least fully aware of what's happening and is able to explain what they have done. So the vivas will be brief, but will be conducted. Discretionary marks is basically, I mean, if you fall at the border of a grade, then I may sort of see whether, based on class participation, can you be, is your grade affected? This is never going to be negative, okay? But it only if you are sort of falling short of a grade and you have been performing well in the class otherwise, that will be considered, but should not matter to most people. Code of conduct. Since 60% of the grade is based on assignments, you are expected to solve them individually. There will be random testing of code for duplicates or plagiarism. That's basically copying either from other classmates or from somewhere on the internet. If you are using online sources or if you have discussed with someone else, you are expected to state that clearly upfront in your submission. Not in a separate email, not somewhere else, but clearly in your submission as part of the comments, you should say, I discussed this with so-and-so and then implemented it on my own. It's not acceptable to say I discussed it with so-and-so, didn't understand what was happening and therefore took his code. That's not okay, right? But if you say that I discussed it, I understood the idea and therefore, and then implemented it, that is acceptable, okay? But if you just directly take code from somewhere else and put it in, that's not okay. You are expected to be doing this on your own. We generally follow the principle of something called an honor code. You are on your honor that if you say that you did not copy, I'm not going to look too deep into it. But if I look at random and find that you did copy, that's it. I mean, you know, the punishments, basically, there are graded punishments as described by the disciplinary committee. I'm hoping it does not come to that. But please be aware upfront that this is taken seriously. Do not, if you have a doubt, please ask. Am I allowed to talk to someone else about this? Please ask. I will let you know yes or no. So, quickly describe assignment one. Like I said, this is more of a practice assignment to check a couple of things. One is, do you understand C programming? Do you understand the Fourier transform? And are you able to implement an assignment, you know, a problem like this in the context of the course that we have? First of all, what's the definition of the discrete Fourier transform? It's this equation, right? It comes down to this. X of k is sigma n equal to 0 to n minus 1, x of n e power minus j 2 pi k n by n, okay? Where the small x corresponds to some input samples, the capital X corresponds to the output DFT, discrete Fourier transform data. And there are fast algorithms that exist for computing the DFT. That is what we usually refer to when we say the fast Fourier transform, right? So the basic thing that you're computing is the DFT. How you are computing it is the FFT. So the FFT, in other words, is the algorithm that you're going to use, okay? The most common one is something called the Cooley-Tukey algorithm, although there are many variants of that as well. it's up to you. You are free to basically go refer online material, refer textbooks, whatever you want. Come up with an algorithm that will implement this. Okay. Please, of course, cite your references, right? Make it clear which you are using. As far as this is concerned, if you go to Wikipedia, you'll pretty much find, you know, C++ code for this directly over there. But the point is, I would rather prefer that you can give the reference, but then write the code on your own, right? Like I said, this is not something new. This is not something that I want to test whether you know how to, whether you are able to come up with a new algorithm for the FFT. It is a very well-known algorithm, but it's for your own benefit that you actually try and write the code on your own and make sure that you're able to make it pass all the tests. So broad structure, this is an example. One of the possible approaches that could be used, it's called the decimation in time fast Fourier transform. Basically it takes the input data and splits it up into the even part 0, 2, 4, 6 and the odd part 1, 3, 5, 7 samples, combines them using two n/2 point DFTs, and finally, you know, do some other adding up the data in different ways as per these two equations on the side over here, and you get the final outputs. Okay, what is the approach that you are actually going to use in order to implement this as C code? That's up to you. What we are going to assume is a couple of things. One is use the float data type, floating point numbers, and the std colon complex, it's a template class in C++. Okay, there is a way of doing complex numbers in pure C as well, but that usually ends up being too complicated. We'll just assume that we are interested in powers of 2 for n to make life simpler. And what you are expected to do is to implement for a range of n values. Okay, get an FFT that works for a range of values. You can implement for the others as well, but that's sort of optional. Why this range is that ultimately what I want you to do is to actually run it, time it, and find out how long it takes in order to run on a given processor, right? And you should be able to sort of say that yes, it actually goes as sort of n log n rather than n squared. So as far as I'm concerned, if you write five different functions here, a 16 point FFT, 64 point FFT, 256 point FFT, etc., and then you have one master function, right? So this is what the test bench will look like, right? It'll have some headers. The main will basically define some constants. There'll be something that reads the inputs. And then this part over here is the one that's basically going to call the FFT function, okay? It basically takes the input, which is going to be an array, takes n, the number of values that need to be computed, and generates the output. The test bench will also read out the expected outputs from somewhere, right, and check the outputs. What that check means is, one way of checking is, did you get exactly the same output as what we computed using MATLAB or Python or whatever? Another way of checking is, okay, maybe you got a few errors, but the errors, as long as they are numerically small, I'll tolerate them. So that will typically what we'll be doing as far as the checking outputs is concerned. Okay? The compute FFT part is the portion where you will need to fill in your code. The rest of the test bench will be given to you. You just need to make sure you follow this calling convention. It has to have this name and take arguments in this form. The exact details will be given to you later. Okay. Last slide before we get to the quizzes. Just some administrative details. For those of you who don't know me, this is my name, Nitin Chandrachudan. This is my email address, nitin@ee.iitm.ac.in. My office is room number 245C in ESB, but please don't come there without checking whether I'm actually going to be there first. Send me an email, fix an appointment time, and you can come. Okay. There are 6 TAs for the course. The contact information, basically their email IDs, will be provided on the course website. By the way, the course website itself, this time rather than using Moodle, we are going to be using something called the NPTEL course builder. We'll be running it in a restricted form where only the people signed up for the course will have access to it, but you will need to be approved for access to that. So if you are not, if your email is not, please, okay. This is the website, onlinecourses.nptel.ac.in. The relevant portion is this one, the NOC19_EE33. Okay. I will also be creating a mailing list as part of this and using it for announcements, and we'll send out this link as well to you. So at least all the students who are already registered through the academic website, I have your email IDs, I have already added them to the list. So you should be getting an email within the next couple of days saying this is the website, go sign in and so on, right? But if you have not registered through the academic website, please send me an email separately so that I can add you. You need to have some kind of Gmail ID, either Smail or even gmail.com works, right? Which you can use in order to sign into this. Email will be the regular form of communication. You are expected to check email at least once a day, okay? Because there might be some notices that we give at short notice. Usually the sort of short notice will be more things like, you know, logistic changes, classes canceled or classes shifted, or today will be a lab session or something like that. But so any other things like, you know, there's going to be an exam will be done separately. But as far as the micro quizzes are concerned, there will be no announcements. They could be any day, any time. Okay. So that's basically it as far as the presentation part is concerned. Any questions? Okay. So then what we'll do is we'll move on to the next part, which is basically going to be a written quiz. The TAs will hand out the question paper, and you know, you should need probably around 10 minutes or so in order to finish it up. Please just go ahead and fill it out to the best that you can. Like I said, although yes, it does have marks that count towards your final grade, but you know, if there are 10 such quizzes, this is like going to be less than 1% of your final grade. So don't worry about the marks over here. What is important is that you are able to use this to identify whether or not you are okay with what you are expected to already know at this point. Okay. All right. So the next class will be tomorrow at 10, G slot, right? We are going to be following the regular Institute G slot class. The only thing to keep in mind, since this is an M.Tech course, the Monday G slot will be at 12 o'clock. I think for B.Techs it's at 1. So we'll be following the M.Tech schedule. Okay. And any other questions, you can email. All right.